So now's the time where we're going to share our experiences in Borrega. But children, I don't know about you, but in school, if a teacher talks for a really long time, do you sometimes ever get a bit bored? Because even in staff meetings, I'm 25, and when someone's talking for a really long time, I get a little bit bored, and sometimes I switch off. Not in sermons, just in staff meetings. So, what we have got for you is we have got Borrega Bingo. Now, adults, if you think you might switch off as well, you're more than welcome to join in as well, but hopefully we'll entertain you enough. But what we've got is we've got 10 words that hopefully, if I've instructed my team properly, they should say at some point when they're giving their feedback. Now, what you need to do is listen out really, 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 really carefully for those words. If you hear them, you need to tick them off. And when you've got all of them, you need to stand up. It doesn't matter if someone's talking, because that's the fun of it. You need to stand up and shout, Borrega Bingo, okay? And we have some prizes for children that managed to get all 10 of the words. So if you would like to have a go at our Borrega Bingo this morning, I'm going to hand these out to the team. And if you want to come and get a Borrega Bingo sheet, then you are more than welcome. I've got pencils here as well. For the grown-ups as well, now sometimes it gets towards the end of the service and my stomach starts rumbling and I think a little bit about what I'm having for lunch. We have got that covered today. We have got some Tanzanian donuts for you to have a little nibble on whilst we're talking to you. Just want to say a big thank you to my mum because I made them all last night, but she spent about an hour this morning frying them. So thank you, mum. But what I will do is if the rest of the team could come and get baskets, it's a bit like the feeding of the 5,000. If you would like a donut, feel free to take one and have a nibble.
So, if you can, obviously you've got your food now. There's a double reason we gave you this, because obviously no one's going to be speaking with their mouth full, so we can keep you nice and quiet. So Gary, who is at the back at the moment, is going to kick things off, and then we're going to go through the team as well. So hand over to Gary, who has a mouthful, it looks like.
Never to speak with your mouthful, but these are really good mandazi, okay? They're not donuts, they're called mandazi. Right, I don't know, you may know that just before the team left, Mike Mitten and myself left for Borrega, and we went about a week before the team left, and we went in a particular role, and I use that word advisedly because we went on behalf of bread. So I thought I might try and explain the bread role to you. Thank you very much. And anybody that joins the team of trustees for bread, of course, become members of the bread board. We only named it that because we wanted those silly jokes. So Mike and I are trustees of bread, which stands for Borrega Relief Equipment and Development Trust. And we thought we'd do something different this year, and we put out a number of invitations through various church networks to invite churches and organizations to come and join us in Borrega to do some practical work. And our first thoughts were that we would help to build a school. Our ambition was to build at least 2, maybe 3, maybe 4 classrooms for the new English medium school in Borrega. And we were going to be doing this with a new technology of bricks, and it was all very exciting, and we put these invitations out. We have to say the response wasn't huge. And in the end, it came down to effectively 2 churches. Well, it was 3 really, because we did have one member from St. Mary's in Margate, Chris, who's unable to be with us today, which is a bit of a shame because he joined our team. So in our role as Bread, we invited these teams, and the two teams that came were Merland Rise Church and New Life Church. So the idea was that Mike and I would go out there and get everything prepared and ready for the teams to come. We made sure that all the accommodation was there, the luxury accommodation, 5-star, except 4.5 of them dropped off. And that there were mozzie nets and all those other kind of things. So we went out there for the practical idea. Now, as I said to you, we were hoping to build these classrooms, and sadly that didn't come about because the brick machine, the machine that was there to make the brick, didn't actually make it to Tanzania in time. And I was quite disappointed about that, and so I was praying about it, being very miserable and walking around. But then I believe God actually spoke to me and he said, actually, there are two things people need in Borrego. The first thing is, of course, they need Jesus. And, you know, I don't think any of us could argue with that, or most of us wouldn't argue with that. But they also need water as well. And so we actually did concentrate a lot more on doing some water projects, but also sharing the gospel. And I think it's one of the most successful trips we've had. It's been a great trip. It was a real privilege to work with this team. But please don't forget there was another team there from New Life in Congleton, which is near Manchester, which apparently is up north somewhere, but, you know. Beyond Watford, so they did get their passes. Okay, so Bread's role in all of this was to be, if you like, project manage the whole affair. But the real work was done by these teams, and they're going to tell you more about that now.
Okay. I feel like I'm in the way. So just as Gary said, there were two teams that went out, but actually while we were there, we were one team. We joined together, and I think we do have a photo. I think, do I have to use this thing? So this is all of us, so there's 21 of us. There were 12 from Congleton and 8 from our church, and then Chris obviously joined our team as well. So what we're going to do is different members of the team are just going to come up and share some of their experiences and share some of the work that we did. So just bear with us while we're passing the mic around and things. But I do believe that Dave is coming to talk to us first.
I'm talking about the SONAB work that we did in Borrego. Now, SONAB stands for the School of Nursing at Borrego. Now, nursing is very important. They have a great shortage of nurses in Tanzania, and they need to get more and more people there. Now, the school currently teaches a number of pupils, but they need resource from the hospital because there aren't enough people going through to make the accounts balance. So the idea was to build a additional tutorial room and an additional extension to the admin block. The building had been built. It had walls, it had ceiling and floor, but it hadn't been painted, so it was in no way ready for the new class, which was due to start in September. The extension building was, when we arrived, they hadn't built the foundation yet, but that was planned for the first weekend. The local workers, called fundis, were going to be involved in doing that. So we had to get on with the painting of the tutorial block. Now, when we started, we're there. Now, Chris, the guy from the Margate Church, he volunteered to lead the team who were going to be involved in the painting. So it was Chris, myself, Jeff and Sue, who are the leaders from Congleton, together with a number of their team, and Neil, helped us on the painting. There was Catherine, Amanda, and then the three young girls, Zoe, Hannah, and Amy. Now, interesting, these are buildings not as big as this room, but tutorial rooms were quite large, quite tall, because you have to have tall rooms out in Tanzania because of the heat. You can't have low ceilings. The walls were bare plaster, or like render, it's rough plaster. The internal walls were just wood. Windows were wood with metal bars on them, tin ceiling. So in no way was it ready for any tutorial or for people to actually start learning in there. We started off with, I think, half a dozen rollers. No roller trays. Bit difficult that. So we spent the first day around the market, which is on Mondays, buying washing up bowls so that we could use as roller trays. Large gaps in the wood between the woodwork and the plaster work. There are holes everywhere. And we ended up painting the building. So it ended up looking very nice. It had, I think, probably 6 coats of paint from emulsion that's used predominantly as a primer, and then 2 or 3 coats of, if I say white, it's sort of white, gloss that gets rolled on, filled, sanded, rolled again, so that we get a reasonable gloss finish at the end. And then the local fundy, that's Johnny, a local lad who's been working for bread for a number of years, I know. He drew a line all the way round, and under that was different colour, and then there was a green at the bottom, which was ended up looking very nice. I don't know. On the extension building, that was Christian worked on that, I think, mostly with John, Big Tom and Little Tom from Congleton, and along with a couple of other fundies. I forget their names. John was one, I think, and I don't know, remember. Okay. They did most of the actual brickwork, but Christian's job was to get the bricks to them. The bricks handmade at site. So when we turned up, there was a pile of bricks a little bit away from the building. They all need to be carried onto the build site and to where the workers were building. Now each of these bricks, about 2 foot by a foot, probably about 20 kilos each, so 15 to 20 kilos each. And when you're building a building, that's an awful lot of bricks. I think there was over about 500 bricks needed to be carried through. Now my maths ain't good, but that's an awful lot of weight to carry, not very far. Fortunately, we had gloves and things, so hands weren't too badly wrecked, but it was hard physical labor on that team, and they did really well. They ended up building all the walls up to the, there's a concrete plinth that's put around at the top to support the roof. So they built all the way up to that. And so it was when we finished, they were ready for the next stage, putting the roof on and putting the ceilings and the internal wall up. So we succeeded in doing a lot of work. The end of the painting, we ended up scrubbing the floors, sweeping it all out. They were pretty much ready to start. So when we left, they should be ready to start their tutorials and finish the work. Next.
Thank you, Dave. Okay, so me and Joe were mostly involved in building plinths. And as you can see, that's me with a shovel and John. And it was everything that we had to do was manual. So at first, on our first water plinth, we didn't really know what we was doing. We were just digging and getting dirt, following the fundies, which are labourers. That's what we basically did. And everything was manual with a pickaxe. We had to mix cement with a shovel, collect all the water. On the first one, it was quite difficult. We didn't really know what we was doing. But eventually, we actually was involved in building 7 water plinths. So by the second or third one, Joe and myself, we knew what to do.
We were experts.
Yeah. We were the water plinth experts. And when we was told, oh, there's another one, there's going to be another one, Joe and myself was like, yeah, no. Yeah, off we went. As you can see, that's a lovely, smooth plinth there, lovely, smooth concrete. It's not finished, but, you know, and that's the water tank, which holds 5,000 litres worth of water. So basically, in the end, we built seven, which is 5,000 litres of water, times seven, which is 35,000 litres of water that for the rainy season, which is an amazing achievement for us to be involved in because water is such a big issue. And yeah, and that's the finished article, one of them anyway. So when the rainy season comes in January next year, the villagers will be able to access water a lot easier than what they can at the moment when it's not the rainy season. And from personal level, a little testimony, when I was first involved in the water plimps and I was shoveling dirt and cement, I really thought, have I really come all the way to Borrega to shovel dirt and cement? And actually, and then I spoke to God about it because I was like, oh, I can't believe I've come all the way to Africa to do this. Anyway, God gave me a vision and said, you know, any job that you do for me, you know, the bigger picture is 35,000 litres worth of water, which taught me a massive lesson that any job that I now do or anybody does, never think that it's not big enough or that it's not important enough because God knows the bigger picture. And the vision is, you know, water is so precious. And as my husband always says to me, no water, no life. And that actually has two meanings to me, but, you know, that's what I've come away with.
Now, Michelle's quite hardcore. She, like, got involved with the cement mixing and everything. For those of you who know me, I'm not very good at that kind of thing. So our project was a little bit more arty, a little bit less laboursome in that sense. So Neil, Michelle and I, we were working in the orphanage and there were two rooms that were used as classrooms, but they were really dirty, they weren't great. Neil and Princess, sorry. And they're really dirty, really horrible, and the children were having school in there every day, and it just wasn't a nice place to have school. So we basically got our artistic skills together and just decorated these two classrooms to make it more aesthetically pleasing for them. So these are just some of the pictures of what we did and how it ended up. And then we've got a picture of a couple of the children at the end with us. And they were just, we also had special blackboard chalk because the blackboards they had were really awful. So they now had a brand new blackboard that would really help them in their school. So that was the kind of things that we did. Oh, and also, Dave is like health and safety man. And he had loads of, well, they were like outfits, weren't they? We had, I don't know what you call them, like hard hats, boots, gloves, what are those things called? Like all in one? Boiler suits. And basically we left them out there for the men to use. So I don't know if you can see, it's not very clear, but the bottom picture is Dave giving all of the equipment and things to Titus. And also, because Dave is just brilliant, he had loads of first aid kits for us that we took out, and luckily we didn't really have to use them. So the picture on the top left is just him handing them over to the hospital, because they obviously needed them much more than we did. Princess.
So, when we first decided to go to Tanzania, I was really worried about it. And I thought, how am I going to be at building? But I prayed and I felt that God really said to me, no, you need to go. So off I went with my hard hat, prepared for anything. But when I got there, within a couple of days, it became apparent that I wasn't going to be so much building, but I was going to be teaching in a secondary school. So on the first day, my transport came to pick me up And off I went on the back of a motorbike to school. And when I got there, I was faced with two classes of girls, 90 children in each class. The first class were 14-year-olds, and the second class were 17-year-old girls, who were all really lovely. And so these are some of the teachers. So I taught biology, life sciences, and a few other subjects that I think nobody else wanted to teach. By the end of my time there, I'd become really, really close to all of the girls, and I was really sad to go, and they were sad to see me go. So when I came home, I prayed again, and I felt God said to me, "It's not over yet. You need to look more." So I made some inquiries, and on the Wednesday, I came home on the Friday, and on the Wednesday, I got a phone call from a tutor at Nescot saying to me, would you like to come here and do your PGCE with us? And we'd like you to lecture 2 days a week in our science department. So as of 2 weeks ago, I now have another job, and I am working two jobs. I'm official lecturer at Nescot, and I'm doing my PGCE in teaching for higher education. And if I hadn't have gone to Tanzania and I hadn't have listened in the first place, none of it would have happened. So if it's taught me anything, it's taught when you pray and you get an answer, even if you don't understand, there is a plan and there is a bigger picture.
And I think, as Gary mentioned, we didn't get the bricks we wanted for the school, but just a quick update. The school that was a lot of the things we advertised that we were building, the money that was raised is going to build that school. So we just thought we'd show you. We did do some work on the school. This is Dave and Chris doing a bit of the work. Basically, it's a bit more technical than the average Borrega building. So we've got a lot more to do on the work on the foundation. So this is just to show you that the work is getting done and those schools will be built. And I'm sure when we get the pictures back of the built schools, we'll share them with you again. So that's the work that we did. And now John's going to come and share about the kids' club.
Kids' club. We did three kids' clubs. All on a Tuesday afternoon. We filled the church up on the first day. There were over 300 children turned up on the first kids club, which was quite overwhelming for us. So we did art and, well, just craft, not art. Well, we did a little bit, or tried to, with them. And games, and we did some dramas. And the dramas that we did were The Lost Sheep, The Parable of the Prodigal Son, and we did the story of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. We tried singing, which went down quite well. We had some help from the nurses. Two nurses came to translate for us and try and control the children. You can see them there playing games and just having great fun. We would start the afternoon normally with a game of rounders, which was played sort of Borrega rules, so nobody actually got out at all, but they all managed to get a rounder, I think, so that was quite good. Yeah. So the first one, we had over 300 children. I think that's because it was advertised throughout the village and beyond. The other two kids' clubs, we didn't do that, and there were still over 200 children there, so made it a bit more manageable for us. So that was the kids' clubs.
When we go to Borrega, obviously the work that we do is really important, but something that's very much on my heart and on the heart of lots of others is building relationships. Some of us have been many times, and it's always lovely to be welcomed back by friends. And an area that I love is the orphanage. I'm quite broody, I love children, and if you could catch me anywhere in my spare time, it would be in the orphanage. And basically, the children out there in the orphanage, you know, they love their children out there, but in a different way, in that children out here, we play with them, we look after them, we have lots of fun with them, whereas a lot of children out there, there's kind of like a round hut, and they're just left there for most of the day. There's not really a lot of engagement with them. So for me, a real big part of it is spending time with those children and playing with them and loving them. And these are just a couple of pictures of some of the children that we spent time with. I particularly fell in love with one little boy, Moses, here in the top left, and it was incredibly hard to leave him. But it was just really lovely to be part of it and to spend time with those children and build relationships with them. And just if we went back to that last slide. Celia was really kind to get her ladies, like her knitting ladies, to make lots of teddy bears, and they went down an absolute treat. They don't have a lot of toys out there, so we handed them out, and that's just Hamza with a couple of the teddy bears, and it was really lovely to see babies with these teddy bears really loving them. And children here, you know, a knitted teddy bear, what's that? But out there, it was a really big thing for them, and it was a real privilege to give them that. And then something else that happened that's never happened to me before, because I don't think my friends love me enough, I met the quads that Uta has adopted. They have a cousin, and she was pregnant when we were out there, and she was ready to have her baby. And I joked with her one day through kind of translation, if it's a girl, you should call it Christina. And she had a girl, and she called it Christina, which was really overwhelming. It was a real blessing. And I did say to her, I only meant it as a joke, but to have a baby named after you, hint, hint, dowies, was a real privilege and a real joy. So that was something that really blessed me. And that's me with baby Christina. So, yeah.
So, village life. Well, these are our bedrooms. They were quite small. I was lucky that I had one on my own. We slept under mosquito nets. Most of the time we didn't have electricity, so we used head torches. This is our bathroom. This was the bit that I was dreading most about going. Let's just say that the toilets take a lot of practice. And that because there's not electric, it gets very interesting in the evenings. Apart from the bats and the moths and the flies, there's a lack of water. So we had a bucket of water and had a bucket needed to last 2 or 3 days. So up on the top there is the hospital. We spent a little bit of time up there. The next picture is, this is the football pitch. So we went to football one day. They had a match up there, and they'd created a stadium out of rice bags or potato bags. And they had these big white sacks that cordoned off the football pitch area. And they charged us, I think, how many pence was it? 500 shillings? 15p to go in and watch a football match. So that was really good, and they were proud of that.
Princess, just remind me, sorry. I will stop talking in a minute. When she talked about the water and the buckets that we had for showers. And I've never appreciated how much water we have, and this time when we went to Borrego, we've never had such little water, and it's never been such an issue. And we normally had a pump, but this time we had to chuck a bucket down a well. It was very entertaining, and get our water out. And a bucket of water had to last us sort of 2 or 3 days for showers. And one evening I went to Uta's house, and she's got a normal toilet, which you get excited about because you can use a real toilet for an evening. But because there was so little water, it didn't flush. So you had to fill a bucket, tip it in the cistern to get it to flush. And what really shocked me was how much water it takes to flush a toilet. And I know that sounds really silly and really gross, but it was at least half a bucket of water, which for us was a day's shower. And I just really felt challenged this time, like how much water do we waste here? And one thing when we have our own home that I want to do is try and save water by, you know, putting something in a system, because we just take our water for granted. You know, when we brush our teeth, we leave the tap running, or, you know, we wait in the shower. I've tried really hard to get in, start in a cold shower and let it heat up, which I tell you is not easy. But how often do we just let our shower run for ages before it's warm? So my challenge to you is, how careful are you with water and how much do you appreciate water? That's something that really spoke to me.
So we just thought we'd finish this by giving like an update on some of the people that we've met on trips before, because one of the big things for us is not just doing the work, and what's important to the people of Borrego is the relationship that we have. They say they don't want just the money, they want us to be there. So we're just going to give a quick update on some of the friends, so some of the progress that's been. So this is a picture of a little girl called Jenny, who is an orphan. She had HIV, well, she still has HIV, so she's not particularly easy to get someone to adopt, but we've seen her for the last three or four trips, and this is the woman on the right now. She's growing into a teenager, a young woman, and has been adopted by a church worker at one of the local churches, so that's a really good update for us. This is a little chap called Hamza, who a few people will remember. He's now six or seven. He's growing up, and you'll hear a little bit more about him later. These are the quads. These are Uta's kids. There's pictures of, I think, Vicky from a trip. How old are they now? They're 10? Nine. So 9 years ago, when they were just babies, and now they're growing up into large Germans. And that's Uta. That's basically the only picture we took of Uta we've discovered. But I think it's a nice apt photo, because whenever we saw Uta, she did have a coffee in her hand. These are just some of the updates. So it's not very clear, but the girl in the middle is the daughter called Asafiwe, of one of the cooks who was cooking for us the first trip, which I wasn't on, but the first trip 13 years ago. She was cooking, and we still have a relationship with her, and this is her daughter. This chap on the left with Neil is the little boy that they talked about so much after the first trip, a little smiley boy who is now a smiley man, who has got his own wife, he's got his own kid, and even though it's 13 years since this 7 or 8 year old first met us, he still asks after people who haven't been for 5, 6, 7, 8 years. He still asks, he still wants to know. That little boy has grown into a lovely man now named Jonah. We'll sort the prizes out in a second. This is just some of the nursing students who were really welcoming. So these are people who haven't come from Borrego, they've come from all across Tanzania to come to the nursing school, and they were essential to us, and we gave them a football at the end, which they really appreciated. And this is just the final one. It's just this is Pastor Chahumba, or Canon Chahumba, who a lot of people will know. He ran the Bible school out there. He is always saying hello. He speaks very good English, but what he'll do is you'll speak to him Swahili, he'll go, "Ah, now you speak Swahili," and then speak to you in Swahili. But he's been there the whole 13 years, and this is his family, and Mike and Gary, they're not part of his family, but he retired while we were out there, so he's no longer going to be the pastor, but we were really blessed and privileged to be able to give him a gift, which meant that he's going to be building a house still in the same area. It's just across the river. He's not going to be right on our doorstep if we come, but there was talk of him having to go miles away towards Dar to find accommodation. So we were able to contribute financially and through the gifts that we've been given to contribute to this chap's house. So he's got having a house built just the other side of the river. And I think that's really, for me, that's what Tanzania is about. It's not about just throwing money at bricks and at faceless images. It's about investing in these kind of people. So thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. Well done, everybody. That's smashing. Really good report back. Lots of nice picture. You feel you understand better, don't you, what was being done in Borrego. So thank you very much, everybody. Now, the children are going out.